God bless you, sir. You've been born again?
See, there will be no conversation with God on the day you die.
Still got to believe in Jesus, sir.
You know, today a lot of people say, hey, let's have a conversation about this.
God bless you, sir.
And then in these last days, God has spoken through his son. And what did the son of God say? He said, people hate me because I tell them their deeds are evil. Did you know Jesus said that? People hate me because I tell them their deeds are evil.
God bless you, sir.
Walks into a religious temple, sees the corruption of the religious leaders, and he says, you brood of vipers, you thieves. Jesus said to a woman who was in her fifth or sixth relationship, you've been married five times and now you're shacking up. Jesus told the rich young man, hey, give it up.
You've been born again, sir?
Sell it all. Follow me.
Are you getting drunk out here?
Jesus said hard things, folks.
What goes in, what defiles, what comes out.
Jesus said if you're all right.
The Bible does condemn drunkenness, though, sir.
Pluck it out because
you've been born again?
In heaven with one eye.
Do you believe in God, obviously?
With both.
So if you would you consider yourself to be a good person? If you died tonight, where would you go, heaven or hell?
I'm going to be with the
You see people walking down the street, valuing their physical body, the way they dress, the way they look.
Be good enough to make it there?
But do you value your soul? Do you value that inside?
Uh-huh. That's what you believe? So, all right, well, let me ask you this just real quick, so I know you got to get going.
That's why when you get
Jesus said that there is a group of people, and so on the day of judgment, they'll say to me, Lord, Lord. And he says, I will say to them, depart from me, you who practice lawlessness, I never knew you. Could there be any chance that you'd be
Jesus
one of those people? So here's what I will ask you to do. The Bible says if you examine yourself, you'll see whether you're in the faith. So what you need to do is you look at your life and say, honestly, are you living a life that's in obedience to God? Now, it's not perfection. Like you said, it's not works, but when you're saved by God's grace, you want to obey it. You want to live your life for Him. So do you desire to go to church and desire to read God's word and pray and do those things? And that's what you need to examine your life. I can't, obviously, I don't know you personally, but just definitely examine your life and see whether you're a believer or not.
God is not mocked.
All right, well, just examine yourself, sir, all right? God bless you, sir. You have a good day.
So God will treat each of us equally. That's why the Apostle Paul in Romans, after he's showing the wickedness of the human heart,
God bless you.
That we are depraved.
God bless you, sir. God bless you, man.
God gives us over to a non-functioning mind. And God gives us over to a debased mind because we worship the creation, ourselves, over and above the God that created us. And God builds this case about both Jew and Gentile being under the wrath of God. And in conclusion, the Apostle Paul says, we're all of sin and fall short of the glory of God. So if you want to know how God judges you, He sees everything you say and do and think of you as a friend. You will give an account because it says,
God bless you, ma'am. You've been born again? You believe in God, ma'am? All right, God bless you.
The greater the authority, the bigger the burden you're going to take. If God be prophet Isaiah, stood before the Almighty.
Good news of Jesus Christ. All right, God bless you, sir. You believe in Christ, sir?
Yep.
All righty. When you stand before an almighty, holy God, you're going to want to disappear. Because no man can see a holy, righteous, good God and his sin and live.
How you doing today? Here you go, sir. God bless you. God bless you, sir. How you doing, sir?
Sin is death. In other words, God will equally give each one of us the same sentence. Guilty of sin. Judgment is coming. The wage of sin is death. What does that mean? Death is to be separated from life. To be separated from life. From life is to be separated from the one who has given you life. See, that's the seriousness of ending up in hell, folks. If no one is in hell, God makes the water, God makes the hops, God brings all the chemicals that make the containers, and when God is not a part of the equation, it's all gone. And when it says your sins have separated you from God, that means if you end up in hell, you're totally separated from the ultimate one of all good, which is God, the one who has given all right.
God bless you, ma'am. God bless you, sir.
It's a place of separation. It's a place of weeping, gnashing, and that's what happened to all sin equally for all of sin. We're like sheep who go astray, each to our own way. And God has given us a great law, and He's placed it within our conscience, the fact that we can say,
God bless you, ma'am.
The ball should bounce the same for everyone, equality. What is the standard?
All right, God bless you, sir.
You too.
The people should be treated fairly in regards to being right and wrong. Who establishes that? Because sometimes the majority establishes things wrong. If we live by the theory of evolution, everything is by accident, meaningless, then why is there authority? Why not dog eat dog? He who is in power controls. Why? Because there is a higher law. There is a higher standard of equality. There is a higher one. God is the one that puts value in us. God is the one that has instilled value in every creature, every person, because He's created us all in His image and His likeness. Our intrinsic value as human beings comes from our Creator.
Give Him clarity, give Him courage. Thank you, Lord, you're with us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Let the Lord use you, brother.
Thank you. God bless you.
Did yours die already?
Oh, no, you just handed me your whole thing, so I put it on.
Sorry, bro. I'm so used to giving you the mic, I didn't realize.
You just handed the whole thing, so I figured I'd just use it.
I don't care.
All right, awesome.
Go for it, bro.
You win. You win. And I was like, okay, I guess he wants me to use the whole thing. Oh, brother. God bless you.
Yes,
you're awesome.
Hello, folks. My name is Lucas Mann. I'm out here with my brother Joe and brother Keith, preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ to you folks. The Apostle Paul wrote in Romans chapter 1, that he is not ashamed of the gospel, for it is God's power for our salvation. It's God's power for our salvation, folks. Therefore, it's imperative that you believe the gospel of Jesus Christ. See, many religious groups around the world these days claim to have a gospel, to have a gospel message that they want to preach to you, to have their own good news. Many of them said they have their own. The Mormons say they have their gospel message. The Jehovah's Witnesses say they have their gospel message. The Catholics say that they have their gospel message. All of the religious groups say we've got our gospel. But the Bible says that there is only one gospel that is the power of God. It's the true gospel of Jesus Christ. What does the word gospel mean? The word gospel is translated from a Greek word euangelion, which means good news. It means good tidings. See, the gospel is good news to the sinner. It's good news because it means that we can be reconciled with our Creator God, that we can be reconciled with the God who has given us life, the God who's made all things. The Apostle Paul wrote in Galatians 1:8, he said, but even if we are an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to what we have preached to you, he is to be anathema. That's a Greek word that means damned, cursed by God. See, my friends, all the religious groups of the world claim to have their own gospel message. They claim to have their own good news. But the Bible says that there is only one true gospel message. There is only one truth that will save your soul from hell. There is only one gospel message that is the... Oh, sir, even if you're not drinking, you still need salvation in Jesus. You must be born again, sir. It doesn't matter if you're living a nice, clean, religious life and you go to church every day of your life, you still need to be saved from your sins. But as I was saying, the Bible says there's only one truth, only one gospel truth that is the true gospel truth, and it's the only one that will save your soul and the only one that will make you right with your Creator God. What is the gospel message according to God's Word, according to the Bible? What does God define the gospel as? We've got to be very clear on this. What is the gospel according to Scripture? Thankfully, God in His Word has spelled it out for us, quite literally. He has put it in writing for us to know what the gospel message is. In the book of 1 Corinthians 15, beginning at verse 1, Paul writes, "Now I make known to you, brethren, the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received, in which also you stand." So Paul says, here is the good news of Jesus Christ. Then in verse 3, he tells us, For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. That is what the gospel message is. The gospel is that Jesus came to die for our sins, to be buried, and to rise again 3 days later. That is the good news according to the Bible. That is the good tidings. That is the euangelion of the scriptures. No other gospel passes the test. If your gospel that you preach and you live by, or your church and your church preaches and they live by, if it is not about Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, it is not the gospel of Jesus Christ. We've got so many people around the world saying we have the truth, we've got true Christianity, or even they're saying we've just got the true God. But if they're not preaching Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, they're false. They're not true. They're lying to you, folks. Only the gospel of Jesus Christ can save from sin. The good news of Jesus. But my friends, in order for us to really understand the good news of Jesus Christ, in order for us to really appreciate the beauty of the gospel of the glory of God, we have to hold it in front of the backdrop, if you will, the dark backdrop of damnation, God's wrath and hell. See, when you go into a jewelry store, they have all the rings and the necklaces and all the diamond jewelry, a lot of times laying across a black felt blanket. What is that for? It's to further accentuate the beauty of the diamond. God bless you, sir. To further accentuate the beauty of the jewelry, because it is compared and it's contrasted with the dark colors behind it. And it's the same way with the gospel of Jesus Christ. In order to fully understand the gospel, in order to truly understand it, what you must do is see the gospel in light of God's just wrath and God's hatred against sin. That is how you must see the gospel. You have to see it in that light. Therefore, I must take time and explain to you the character of God and man's character in light of God. See, my friends, God is good. God is capital G-O-O-D. He is good. And many people would say, of course, I believe this. I believe God is good. However, God's goodness is a cause of fear for us. It should be a cause of terror. God is a good God. Therefore, sin cannot dwell in his presence. And then that gets into his holiness. God is a holy God. He's separated from sin. He's pure and he's lovely and he is righteous. The Bible describes God as the judge of all the universe. The Bible describes God as self-revealing. He's revealed his will to us in his word. He's revealed what his will is for us, folks. He's revealed it clearly to us in his word. God has made known who he is. He also says in his word that he is love, that he is gracious, and that he is compassionate. That is who God is, and he has made himself known, and he's made his will known in his word for us. And my friends, one of the things that God has made known in his word is what his will is for us. See, God has given us a law to obey. He's given us his commandments to live by.
Thank you.
God has given us his commandments to abide by. They're his 10 commandments. And that is the basis upon which he judges people. So let's go and look at the commandments. The commandments act like a mirror. They show us, one, the character of God. They display to us the glorious character of who God is. All of God's commandments are a reflection of his character. And also they show to us the depravity of man's heart. How truly sinful we really are. Because in and of ourselves, we really think we're good enough. We really think we're righteous and we're holy enough. But we're not. We really think we're okay with God, but we're not. That's why we have to look into the law of God. We've got to look at the mirror of God's law and see that we are not good. There's not one good. No, not one. So we've all broken the law of God. We all have. Here's one of God's commandments. God said not to lie.
What team do you play for?
Sir, you need to believe on Christ for salvation. Sir, you need to trust in Christ. Jesus said, unless a man's born again, he cannot... Sir. Sir, Jesus said, unless a man's born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. The Apostle James wrote in James 2. Sir, you need to trust in Christ. You need to repent. You need to repent of your sin and come to Christ. John. So God's character shows us who he is. Or God's law shows us his character. Shows us who he is. But it shows us who we are in light of God's character. Who we are, that we have broken his law. Here's one of God's commandments. He said not to lie. Yet we continually lie. We continually break the law of God. We lie. Here's another one of God's commandments. God said you shall not steal. Yet we steal. Ask yourself, have you ever stolen before? Even something small. Ever stolen something? God said that you shall not disobey your parents. You ever disobeyed your parents before? You're guilty of that as well. God said never to commit adultery. He said you shall not commit adultery. In fact, it was so serious in God's eyes in the Old Testament, he told the Israelites, if you find someone committing adultery, they're to be stoned. That is how serious adultery is in God's eyes. And everybody, and a lot of people say, well, I've never committed adultery. Jesus said if you look after a woman to lust for her, you've committed adultery already with her in your heart. God not only sees the outward, God sees the inward. God sees the heart. God sees our thoughts. Think about that. God sees every thought that goes into your mind, every thought that you think. In fact, not only does God see that, but he sees the intent of your heart. The Bible tells us in the book of Genesis that God looked from heaven and saw that all the intent of the heart of man was to do evil continually. And I could go on through all of God's commandments and thoroughly show you how we have each broken all of them. All you have to do is go look at them. Here's another one. God said, you shall not murder. God's not a murderous God, therefore he wants us not to murder. And many people say, of course, I've never killed anybody. However, Jesus came along in the New Testament and said, if you have hatred in your heart toward your brother, you've murdered him already. God regards that as murder. See, again, God sees the thoughts. God sees the heart. And God sees that we are wicked and ungodly, that we are dead in our sins. We are vile and wretched in the eyes of the Most High God. We can't work our way out of this state. Sir, why are you so angry toward God? Sir, you need to be made right with your Creator. You need to trust in Christ. Sir, you're proving by your speech that you don't know God. You need to be born again. Jesus said, unless a man's born again, he can't see the kingdom of God. No, you have not been born again. So we all stand before God as having broken his law. And it's like this. If someone goes and beats someone up here in New Orleans or murders somebody, they stand before the judge guilty of breaking the law, and they deserve to be punished for their law breaking. It's the same way with God, folks. If you break God's law, you have to stand before God as a guilty sinner, and you've got to be punished for your law breaking. You've got to be punished for breaking God's law. Breaking God's law is not only breaking not only his word, but it's also an offense to his character. It's also an offense to the very character of God. It's an offense to who God is, because it's a rejection of who he is. And we can't work our way out of this. We can't try to do religious work and get ourselves made right with God by our own merits. Can't go see a priest or a pastor and pray enough or read God's word enough. None of that will make you right with God. Because the guilt still is there. If someone stands before a judge as having broken a law, let's say they stole some money from someone, it doesn't matter what amount of good they've done, even if they return the money, the guilt is still there. They've still broken the law, therefore they still must be punished. No amount of good that you do, folks, can get you to be made right with God. Not by the works of the law we justify, but by the hearing of faith. We cannot work our way out of this, folks. Sir, you need to be born again. Jesus said, unless you repent, you will perish. You have not been born again, sir. That's clear. Sir, by your words, you're condemning yourself. By your words, you're showing what's in your heart. Jesus said, the words come out of the outflow of the heart. It shows what's in your heart. I know what's in your heart by your words. So my friends, we stand before God. We can't work our way out of this. We can't get ourselves out of the rut that we're in. We are dead in our sins. Ephesians 2:1 tells us we are dead in our trespasses and sins. So what are we going to do? How can we be made right with our Creator at this point? Because not only are we guilty, but like I said earlier, we have to be punished for our sin. The Bible tells us in the book of Exodus that God will by no means leave the guilty unpunished. So what are we going to do? How are we going to be made right with our Creator? Because God's punishment for sin is very severe, folks. God's punishment for sin is eternity in hell. God throws into hell those who've broken His law. Hell has been reserved for the devil and his angels, but God also throws people into there because they rebel against Him and have broken His law. Because they rebelled against Him. And they've proven themselves to be haters of God. So you need to be saved from hell. Folks, hell is a very terrifying place. Hell is hot. Jesus described hell as a place of outer darkness. You can talk to my friend right here, sir. He'd love to talk with you. Hell is a place of outer darkness. Jesus said that hell is a place of weeping and of gnashing of teeth. Hell is very, very, very real, my friends. And if you're outside of Christ, you're going there. That's what we're here to tell you, that you're going to hell and you need to be saved. You can be freed. You do not have to go to hell. There is salvation in Jesus Christ. But nonetheless, we all stand before God by default in and of ourselves. We all stand before God by default, breakers of His law, guilty, and we deserve hell. We deserve to be thrown into the lake of fire. Sir, you need to not be such a hater of God. You need to be saved. You need to be born again. Sir, you need to be born by the Spirit of God. Sir, you need to be born again. You need to be taken and made a new creation. So we all stand before God in this state. Folks, many of you perhaps stand before God. I would say many of you do. Jesus said many people are on the broad path which leads to destruction. All of us by default are on that broad path that leads to destruction. Every single one of us are. And God is totally just in doing that. God is totally just in sending people to hell. In fact, if we wanted justice right now, we'd all be in hell. But instead, the mercy of God holds back His just wrath. And my friends, not only is God just, but praise His name that He's also gracious and compassionate. And what God did in His love and in His grace toward mankind while still upholding His justice and His righteousness, He sent His Son Jesus. So I cannot help but be loud and proclaim the gospel. So God in His love for mankind sent His Son Jesus. Jesus Christ came, eternal God, fully God and fully man. He came and lived a perfect life. He was born of a virgin. He lived a perfect life. He was never once disobedient to the law of God. See, here's the thing. Every day we fall short of the glory of God. We break the law of God day after day after day. But Jesus Christ, every moment of every day, He was perfectly obedient to the law of God. In fact, the Bible tells us in Matthew 3, He pleased the Father. Sir, you can't keep the law of God. In no way. That's why you need to be saved. Excuse me, sir. I gotta continue to preach. So, my friends, you must believe on Christ to be saved. He came and He lived that perfect life and then He laid Himself down on the cross. And what happened to the cross was so important and so incredible. He went to the cross and He laid Himself down as a sacrifice, as the sacrificial Son of God, as the Lamb of God, appointed by God the Father to be our salvation. Jesus said in John 14:6 that I am the way and the truth and the life, and no one comes to the Father but through me. See, folks, many of you are mocking God, but God says in the book of Galatians chapter 6, He says, whatever you sow, you will also reap. Do not mock God. God will not be mocked. So you're condemning yourself by your words. You're showing what's in your heart. You hate God. Sir, you hate God. You need to be made right with your Creator. Jesus said if a man is born again, then he will be able to see the kingdom of God. But if he's not, he cannot see the kingdom of God. You will never be able to enter the kingdom of God unless you be born again, sir. You need to fall upon Christ and be saved. You need to repent. Jesus said if you do not repent, you'll perish. So he went on the cross, laid himself down on that cross, and he satisfied the wrath of Almighty God. He went to the tree, and all of our sin was credited over to his account on the cross. Jesus bore our iniquities. He was treated as if he was a liar and a thief and a blasphemer, as if he was acting as this man does. Though in fact he was perfect. The Father treated his Son the way that we deserve to be treated. God poured out on Christ the wrath that we deserve to be poured out on us for all eternity. He paid the fine for us. So if you're a Christian, why are you heckling the preaching of the gospel? Because you're not a Christian. So on the cross, he paid the bill for us. If a murderer stands before a judge and he's guilty, he's about to go into prison. However, if someone steps into the courtroom and pays the fine for the murderer, let's say the fine for his law breaking or his bail, you could call it, was $2 million cash. Someone walks in and pays it. He walks out of the courtroom forgiven. Justice has been served. The law has been appeased and grace has been administered. And that's exactly what God did in his Son Jesus. On the cross, he paid the bail that we cannot pay in and of ourselves. He paid the bail for us so that we could be set free. He paid the bail on that cross for his bride, for his people, the church. He died for those who God would call to himself through the preaching of the gospel and through the proclaiming of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's what happened at the cross of Jesus Christ. So you need to be born again. Jesus said, if you're not born again, you're not going to see the kingdom of God. Jesus said, unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. Quote to me where Jesus said you don't have to repent. That's because that's what Jesus preached. Mark 1:15, he said, repent and believe the gospel. You have to repent, sir. You need to trust in Christ. God can free you from the power of sin in your life because you're controlled by sin. You're dead in your sins, sir. You're dead in your trespasses and sins. You need to be saved. So on the cross, Jesus paid the bail for our sins. He satisfied the wrath of God due unto us in totality. Not a drop is left. Not a drop is left for the people of God. And 3 days later, praise God, Jesus rose from the grave. He's alive today. Jesus reigns as Lord and as King of the universe. He's alive today. And even the resurrection of Jesus Christ has much legal sense to it. In the fact that whenever I go to the store and I purchase an item, they print off a receipt to give evidence to the fact that I paid for the item I purchased. And that is what the resurrection of Jesus Christ was. That God was printing the receipt, if you will.
You keep speaking the word of God. Amen.
God bless you, ma'am. Thank you. Have you been born again?
Oh, yes.
Jesus said, unless a man's born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God.
I am a Christian.
Thank you, ma'am. God bless you.
God bless you.
The word of God is alive and active. It's sharper than any double-edged sword, and it penetrates even dividing the soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and the attitudes of the heart. The word of God is powerful. And I'm preaching the word of God, sir. Yep, you're convicted of your sin. That's why you're yelling out at me. You know that you've broken God's law. You know that you're damned. You need to be saved. You're anathema. You need to be saved by Christ. Jesus is offering terms of forgiveness for those who will come to him and believe. You need to repent, sir, and believe. You need to trust in Christ. You need to repent of your hatred. You need to repent of hating your brother. God sees that in your heart is murder. So he rose from the grave. It was God showing us that the account has been settled. That the fine has been paid. That he accepted the sacrifice of his Son as sufficient, as perfect, and as all that we need. That's what the resurrection of Christ is. And Jesus is alive today, folks. Muhammad, he's dead. And Buddha is dead. Joseph Smith is dead. All the popes, they're all dead. No man can save you, folks. No man can offer you forgiveness. In the hour of death, who can help you? Only the living God. The Bible describes Jesus as the true God and eternal life. He himself is life personified. Jesus is the resurrection and the life, folks. And the one who believes in him will live even if he dies. He's alive today, folks. He's alive today. Sir, if you perished now, you would go to hell for your sins. You need to be saved from the wrath which is to come. So you need to be saved from your sins. You need to be saved from your sins. You've clearly not been born again. He's alive, he's risen from the grave, and he was exalted into heaven, to a throne in heaven, and he's seated there now as the Lord of glory. He's seated on a throne in heaven now as king. He's king of the universe. Folks, he's Lord of your life, whether you believe him or not. Jesus Christ is Lord, whether you confess him to be Lord or not. He's Lord, whether you believe him or not. He's Lord, whether you even know his name or not. Jesus Christ is Lord over your life. And here's what Jesus says you must do to be saved. You want forgiveness of sins? You want to be saved from your sins, folks? Here's what you must do. Jesus said, repent and believe the gospel. Change your mind about your sin. That's what repentance means. Change your mind about your drunkenness and your drug abuse and your love for partying and your love to watch things that God hates on television and to listen to music that God hates. Change your mind about those things. Change your mind about your lying and your thievery and your blasphemy of God's name. So you need to change your mind. You need to repent. I'm calling you out now. You need to be saved.
I ain't got no money to get back on.
Yeah. Sir, you need to be born again. Jesus said if you're not, you can't see the kingdom of God. Sir, you need to be born again. You need to be born in the Spirit of God. So if you change your mind and you believe the message of the gospel, if you change your mind about your sin, and change your mind about salvation, and you realize, I'm not going to trust in myself anymore. I'm not going to trust in my religious works anymore, or in the religious works of another. I'm going to trust in God himself, Jesus the Messiah, Jesus the Lord of glory. You resolve to trust in Christ alone, and that's the second thing, that you believe the gospel. You've got to believe the gospel by faith. You've got to believe that God did what he said he did, that he truly did send his son to die on the cross for our sins and to rise again. No, you do not believe the gospel, sir. You clearly don't. You're still dead in your sins. You're dead in your sins, sir, and you need to be saved. No, they don't. Everyone does not believe. Many people do not believe. That's what we're calling you out here to do today, folks, is to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And you will be saved. Be saved from your sins, my friends. You're not saved, sir. Your words are condemning you. The Bible says you'll be judged for every idle word that you say. What is that? Jesus said, do not judge according to appearance, but judge with righteous judgment. Jesus told his followers to be judges. He told us to judge people. People take verses out of context and think, oh, Christians can't judge other people. Of course we can. Jesus told us to. So my friends, you must change your mind and believe the gospel. Lay hold of the promises of God. Believe that he died and rose again for your sins. And God will forgive you of your iniquities and your transgressions. God will wash you clean of all your filthiness and all your idols. And you will be made clean. You'll be justified in the eyes of the Most High God. God can forgive you, folks. You can have forgiveness of sin through the Lord Jesus Christ because he died on the cross and paid for them already if you believe him. See, our assurance before God is based upon his character, based on his justice, because we realize God cannot punish the same sin twice. Therefore, we know that because he punished Jesus on our behalf, that we have forgiveness and he will not punish us, and he will not punish us for our sin. And praise God for that. Praise be to God for that. Have you been born again? Have you been born of the Spirit of God? Folks, have you been changed? Has God taken hold of you and made you a new creation? See, I don't really care if you've prayed a prayer, you've walked an aisle, or a priest or a pastor told you you were saved. It's about whether you have been made to be a new creation. See, that's the evidence that you've been saved. That's the evidence that God's forgiven you of your sins and that you've been a new creature, that you've been made new. The evidence that you've been saved is that your life has changed. Your actions, your words, your deeds, everything about you has changed. That's the evidence that you've been saved, my friends. See, I was a false convert for many years. I said I knew Christ, but actually in my heart I didn't know Him. It's kind of like if I say, I know the President of the United States, and I walk up to the White House and I say, hey, I know you. He says, I don't know you, I'm not letting you in. See, it's not whether you know God, quote and unquote, or know of God, it's whether God knows you. It's whether God has saved you, whether He's taken you and made you to be one of His children. I want to take you to a text of Scripture that explains this very, very good, in a very wonderful fashion in Ezekiel chapter 36. Ezekiel 36 verse 22, it says, therefore say to the house of Israel, thus says the Lord God, it is not for your sake, O house of Israel, that I am about to act, but for my holy name, which you profaned among the nations where you went. I will vindicate the holiness of my great name, which has been profaned among the nations, which you profaned in their midst. Then the nations will know that I am the Lord, declares the Lord God, when I prove myself holy among you in their sight. For I will take you from the nations, gather you from all the lands, and bring you into your own land. Then I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you will be clean, and I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and from all your idols. Moreover, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will be careful to observe my ordinances. My friends, is this taking place in your life? Has God taken the heart of stone and given you a heart of flesh? Have you been born again? Have you been born of the Spirit of God? Jesus said that if you've not been born again, you can't see the kingdom of God. Folks, look at your life. If you claim to be a Christian, look at your life and ask yourself honestly, have I been changed? Am I really a new creation? Do I love the law of God? Do I love to fellowship with God's people and read God's word and pray? Or instead, do I love to come out to Mardi Gras and get drunk and smoke weed and party? Thank you, officers, for your service. God bless you. You need to look at yourself, folks, and see whether you've been born again. If you claim to be a Christian, Jesus said that there are many people on the day of judgment who will say to Him, Lord, Lord, and then He says, I will say to them, depart from me, you who practice lawlessness, I never knew you. Could you be one of those people, folks? Could you be one of those people who say that you believe in Jesus, but by your actions you deny Him? The Apostle Paul wrote in the New Testament that there is a form of people who have an appearance of godliness, but they deny the power thereof. They say that they are believers in Jesus, but they deny the power thereof by their actions. They love to come and party and drink and worship the things of this world and worship themselves and be the god of their own destiny rather than serve the true God. Rather than serve the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Folks, you have to be born again. The wrath of God is coming, and it's coming soon. The day of judgment is coming, friends. We're out here to tell you this. I come out here because I've been motivated by the love of Christ. My brother Joe here, we've been motivated by the love of Christ because the love of Jesus Christ constrains us. We must tell you that if you're outside of Jesus, you're going to hell. You're going to go to hell if you're outside of Christ, folks. Believe on Him so that you will be saved. And don't just wear a cross necklace and go to church and pray a couple prayers every once in a while and think you're okay with God. No, you've got to be born again. Everything about you's got to be changed. You've got to be changed by the Spirit of the Most High God. If God won't save you, you'll never be saved. You've got to be changed by the Spirit. We plead with you. We cry out to you this day. Trust on Christ. We live in a nation that is in a famine right now. We live in a nation that has a horrible famine across its land. What is it? What's the famine? It's a famine for the word of the Lord. We don't have many preachers these days preaching the truth of the word of God. Preaching that sin is bad and hell is hot. Jesus saves and God is glorious. My friends, Jesus saves from sin. He saves from drunkenness. Many of you are out here getting drunk, and he saves from drug abuse. Many of you are out here abusing drugs and alcohol. Jesus saves from those things, folks. Many of you folks are out here dressed like prostitutes out here on the streets. Jesus saves from that. Jesus saves from bondage to sin and sexual morality. Many of you are having sex out of marriage. The Bible says that that's a sin in the eyes of God. The Bible says, do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor homosexuals will enter the kingdom of God. You got to be saved from your sins, folks. We live in a nation that celebrates sexual immorality and celebrates sexual sin. But God hates it. It's a detesting thing in His eyes. It grieves the heart of God. Folks, you need to repent of your sin and trust in Christ. He frees from all sin. Many of you are living in worldliness. You love the things of this world. You love to talk like the world and dress like the world and use the language and the jokes that the people in this world do. You need to repent of your worldliness and trust in Christ. You need to find hope in the Savior. Folks, don't live in worldliness. Instead, find true life in Jesus Christ. What is the greatest fear in this life? What's the greatest fear that people experience around the world? I want to ask you guys, what is the greatest fear that people experience across the world, no matter what color your skin is, no matter what culture you're from, no matter how much money you make? What is the greatest fear that you can experience in this life, folks? What is it? The greatest fear is this: death. Greatest fear that we have is death. Where am I going to go when I die? A lot of people want to avoid the problem of this by saying, well, there is no God, so there's nothing after you die. That's foolish, just because they know that there is a God. God doesn't believe in atheists. Atheists don't exist. Atheists don't exist. Everybody knows in their heart that there is a God. Everybody in their heart knows. No, sir. No, sir, that's not true. Jesus Christ is so real. I can testify to that. Praise God. Can't you, Brother Joe? God, Jesus is real. The greatest fear that we can experience in this life is death. Where am I going to go? God bless you, ma'am. And you know, we put millions of dollars every year in studying about medical science, how we can better escape the death, how we can make life expectancy longer and hopefully escape the sting of death, but we'll never escape it. But great, here's a statistic for you, folks. 10 out of 10 people die. 10 out of 10 people die. No matter where you're from, how much money you make, or who you are, guess what? You'll die. All of us do.
Everybody gonna die.
That's right. 10 out of people die. But the question is, will you live after you die? Whether you have eternal life in Christ, that's the question. And thankfully, Jesus came along in the New Testament, and He provided some incredible answers. In the book of John, chapter 11. Now I want to give some background to this story real quick. One of Jesus' friends had died. His name was Lazarus. He was dead in the grave. He was dead 4 days. Jesus came and visited Lazarus' tomb on the fourth day. Mary and Martha were there. They were also friends of Lazarus. And in verse 25, I'm sorry. In verse 18, it says, now Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles off, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them concerning their brother. Martha, therefore, when she heard that Jesus was coming, went to meet him. But Mary stayed at the house. Mary then said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Verse 22, even now I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Verse 25, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even if he dies. Greatest fear in this life, folks, is where you will go when you die. It's the uncertainty of death. And thank God that Jesus Christ came along and said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even if he dies. Jesus gives this promise to you, folks. You're terrified of death. Whether you admit it or not, you're terrified of it. But Jesus said, if you believe in me, You will live even if you die. If you come to Jesus Christ and you submit to Him, you will live even if you die. You'll live eternally if you die, my friends. Jesus said that the one who comes to me, I will by no means cast out. By no means, folks. Jesus says, come and believe in me. You'll live. And not only live in eternity, but you will live in this life. You'll have freedom from your sin. See, many of you out here on the streets right now, you claim to be Christians, but you dress horribly. You're involved in drunkenness and drug abuse and partying. And you show and you prove by your actions that there's no power of God at work in your life. That you're not really a child of God. You're not really born again. You need to be made right with your Creator. Folks, God's law has shown us that we all break it, that we're sinners, that we're haters of God in our hearts, and we are condemned to hell by default, every last one of us. What are we going to do to be freed from hell? What are we going to do? How are you going to be freed from the sentence of hell? How are you going to be freed from your guilt before God? What are you going to do? Sir, if you stood before God tonight, would you be innocent or guilty?
I'm an atheist.
It doesn't matter if you're an atheist. You know that God is real in your heart. The Bible tells us that in Romans 1. You know God to be real. No, He's not, sir. You're suppressing the truth of God in your unrighteousness. God bless you. You need to be born again, sir. That man was lying, guys. He was lying to himself and us. He said he doesn't believe in God. He said God's a fairy tale. But that's a lie. God bless you, ma'am. But that's a lie. It's not true. Exactly. But Jesus said if you believe in Him, you'll live even if you die. That woman was very honest with me. She said, we're just afraid of dying. That's what she just came up to me and said. I was telling her, I was saying about the man who was an atheist just a second ago. He said he doesn't believe in God. The woman said, we're just afraid of dying. That's right. That's right, folks. You are afraid of dying. Be freed from the fear of death by believing in Jesus Christ. Folks, we have a lot of Muslims coming into the country now, and they're spreading Islam and Islamic belief. But believing in that false God will never get you anywhere. Allah is not real. Muhammad is dead. There's no salvation in that God. He's a false God. There's only salvation in Jesus Christ. Only salvation in Jesus Christ. God bless you, sir. Thank you for your service. All other gods are false. They're not real. Only Jesus Christ. Only He is the true God and the eternal life. The atheist denies the existence of God, not because that there is a lack of evidence for God, not because it's so hard to believe in God. It's not that at all. It's because he does not want to be held morally accountable to his Creator, because he knows that his Creator is a just judge, and that his Creator knows right from wrong just as he does, and that his Creator will judge him for his sin. That is why he rejects God. It has nothing to do with evidence. It has nothing to do with logic or facts. It is all about sin. It all boils down to his love for sin and his love for self. He worships himself. That's what it boils down to, folks. He loves himself and he worships himself. Folks, you need to be born again. Just like those atheists need to be born again. See, you are spiritually dead. You cannot react to God in and of yourself. That's why we come out here and say you must be born again. Because you cannot in and of yourself and by your own strength and by your own power make yourself believe in God. You cannot make yourself right with God. God's got to make you right with Him by His own work and His own power. That's why Jesus told Nicodemus. He said that the Spirit of God moves as He wishes. You have to be born of the Spirit of God, my friends. Folks, come, let us deal with you about your soul. Let us talk with you. Let us pray with you. Sir, you right there, have you been born again? Jesus said, unless a man's born again, he can't see the kingdom of God. Let us talk with you about your soul. Let us pray for you. Let us tell you what Jesus Christ has come to do for sinners. Excuse me, ma'am, have you been born again? Jesus said, believe and be saved. If you stood before God tonight, would you be innocent or guilty if God demanded of you your life? Where would you stand with him? I tell you, if you're a human being, which we all are, you'd be guilty before him. Having broken his law, if you're outside of Christ, you'd be guilty before God. Dead in your trespasses and sins and deserving of hell, and you'd be thrown into hell. You gotta be saved, sir. Young man, you must believe on Christ for salvation. Even Jesus' very name in Hebrew is Yeshua HaMashiach, which means the anointed one, salvation. Jesus' very name means salvation. That the Lord provides salvation for sinners. But see, Jesus did not come to say, okay, I saved you from your sin, now just continue going like you did before. No, Jesus Christ came to free us from our sins. Many people, as we've been preaching out here, have come by and said, I believe in God, and yet they're out here just like the world and acting like the world and getting drunk and doing the things that the people of the world do and living no different of lives than the rest of the world. They prove by their actions that they were never changed, that they were never saved. Folks, you got to be born again. Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and the life. And no one comes to the Father but through me. God bless you, ma'am. Folks, the gospel of Jesus Christ is that he came to die for our sins and to rise again 3 days later. That's the good news. Is your hope founded there? Do you believe the gospel of Jesus Christ? Do you believe what he said? Do you believe that he did what he said he did, that he died for us? Have you been raised to walk in newness of life? The Bible tells us if you're in Christ to consider yourself dead to sin but alive to God in Christ Jesus. If you claim to know Christ, let me ask you this. Are you dead to sin but alive to God in Christ Jesus? Are you alive to God?
Yeah.
God bless you, young man. You need to believe on Christ if you haven't trusted in him yet. The Bible says, call upon the name of the Lord and you will be saved. God bid sinners. In the book of Isaiah, he says, come, let us reason together. Though your sins be as crimson, they will be as white as snow. God is offering terms of forgiveness. God is offering terms of forgiveness for sinners, folks. Don't be distracted by the things of this world and don't be distracted by this life. Instead, look to the Son of God. Look to Jesus Christ. The Bible tells us in John chapter 3, verse 14 and 15, that says, just as Moses lifted up serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, so that whoever believes will in him have eternal life. Have you looked to Christ, folks? Have you looked to Jesus Christ and been saved from your sins? Have you come and flung yourself upon the Savior? That's what you need to do, folks. You need to fling yourself on Christ. Find your hope in him. Can you say with the old hymn writer that my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness? I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. It's not about a religious ritual. It's not about saying a prayer. It's about whether you believe on Jesus Christ or not. It's whether your hope is founded in Christ. Is your hope in Jesus? Have you been born again, ma'am? God bless you, young man. You need to believe on Christ and be saved.
Yes, I watched your video.
What's that?
I watched your video.
Really?
Yeah, my Bible teacher.
Yeah.
Wow.
My Bible teacher showed me your videos.
Really?
Yeah.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Was it recently?
Yeah. He's also Christian school. He's also Trinity Christian Academy.
Really?
In Florida. Yeah.
In Florida.
Yeah.
I'm from Orlando.
Oh, yeah. We're from West Palm Beach.
Yeah, he talks about you. We had to take a quick on your video.
What? Yes. Really? What's his name?
His name is Mr. Blasios.
What's his name?
Mr. Blasios.
Yeah.
Weirdest thing. I want to contact him now.
Yeah, I'll give you his email.
Do you have Instagram or something?
Yeah, I got Instagram.
Yeah,
I'll give you his Instagram.
Okay. Wow, what is the chances of that?
Right here at New Orleans.
preacher.
Open air preacher that he took a quiz on with school.
What's the Instagram name?
This is the company. This is awesome.
Mr. Palacio, what's his name,
Mr. Palacio, he's on my email. Did you find it?
Oh yeah, I got it.
You got it?
That's his TC voice button.
I just typed that in?
Mr.
Oh, MR.
Yeah, I'm gonna give you his email until I have it.
PWBC, I think that's it. Yeah, I want to ask him now.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
He teaches 8th through 12th grade boys.
Okay, awesome.
Bible, yeah.
Okay, let me give you his email. I went off so I could give you the email.
Okay, awesome. Thank you. I'm going to make a contact. All right, let's see here. All right, email.
Okay, here we go.
God bless you folks. That's crazy.
Yeah. We're Christians, but you know, we come out every year to the NBA All-Stars.
Oh, yeah, that's cool,
and,
right?
You know, yeah. It's nice. Hold on.
Yeah, definitely not for all this stuff happening over here. It's a pretty bad environment. This is like the gates of hell, you know?
Yeah, it is. But what is the, what's his name? Palacio P? How do you spell it, P? Right here.
Okay. What's the first name?
His name is Sandro.
Sandro. And his last name is Palacio.
Alrighty, thank you.
Tell him Sean.
Yeah, eighth grade
Sean, he knows.
Okay, awesome.
Put that in the
memo. Let me see. I'll just put 8th grade Sean.
Yeah.
That is hilarious.
Uh-huh.
That's hilarious. What's your last name, Sean?
L-O-U.
I-S.
I-S. A-I-M-T.
Alrighty. Yeah, you gotta be careful. They'll hit you with them. Wow, that is hilarious. God bless you,
thank
folks.
You guys.
Hey,
yeah.
Great to meet you.
Yeah, great to meet you.
You know, I want to tell you, I don't tell most people this when I meet out in the streets, but I'll tell you because you and I are real similar age. I'm only 18.
Oh, wow. He's only 18.
That's right. So serve God at your age that you're at right now.
Yeah.
God saved me when I was 15 years old.
Yeah.
He saved me. I was doing drugs and getting into the bad stuff and partying and drinking and all this stuff. But God saved me, did a work in my heart. I believe in Christ now, and God has just given me such grace. And you know, and so serve the Lord at your age, Sean, and follow after God and go preach the gospel to nations. You know, they
need it. We do. Believe me, I preach. I'm his mother, and I.
God bless you.
Believe me, I make sure we do the right thing.
Well, here's what we hand out to people.
People attract each other.
Exactly. I know that's the thing. We've been out here and we've ran into some great people.
Yeah.
This is what we like to hand out to people. A few of these, obviously.
Yeah. This was our last. No, 2 chapters ago.
Wow, that's awesome.
Yeah.
All right. God bless you guys. Hey, I am. That's awesome. They said that they're from West Palm Beach in Florida, and he goes to a Christian school, and his 8th grade teacher showed them videos of a street preacher in class, and it was me.
Ah, that's funny.
And so they said, "You're the guy." No, I have my YouTube. I have my preaching videos on the internet. What's the chances of that? Wow, the providence of God. All right, I'm gonna close up here, folks. I'm gonna close by saying that there is such a joy to be found when you become one of God's people. You find fellowship with other Christians. God is inviting you to be a part of the family of God. What you must do is repent and believe the gospel. Come to Christ and be saved from your sins. Be saved from the wrath which is to come. Or be damned, my friends. We plead with you to be saved by and through and for Jesus and for his glory. Amen.